nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So we were delayed, we were waiting for a quorum, and we're still waiting for one of our members. Susan will not be in attendance tonight. She's unable to make tonight's meeting, but Chris is on his way. Our first item, approval of meeting minutes. Our first approval is for the September 21st, 2015 regular meeting minutes.
So move.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion approved 3-0. Approval of the September 28th, 2015 work session meeting for the library.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion approved 3-0. Approval of the October 5th, 2015 work session meeting interviews.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion, did you?
Sorry. Aye.
Motion approved 3-0. I'm going to pull the October 5th, 2015 work session on agenda preparation to review it. October 5th, so we're moving on to approval October 5th, 2015 regular meeting minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion approved 3-0. For our announcements, we have a proclamation regarding Arbor Day. So I'm quickly going to put the Arbor Day proclamation on the record. Arbor Day, whereas Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world, and whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, lowering our heating costs, moderate the temperature, clean the air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife. And trees are a renewable resource, giving us paper, wood for our homes, fuel for our fires, and countless other wood products. And whereas trees in our town increase property values, enhance the economic vitality of business areas, and beautify our community, and whereas trees, wherever they are planted, are a source of joy and spiritual renewal, therefore, we, the Town Council of Narragansett, Rhode Island, do proclaim April 29, 2016, as Arbor Day here in the town of Narragansett, and urge all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day and support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands. And further, we urge all citizens to plant and care for trees to gladden the hearts and promote the well-being of this and future generations. Thank you, Anne, for preparing that. All right, our next item is our open forum, public comment portion of the meeting. All individuals who would like to speak on issues of concern in the town, please come forward, and we will hear. And I just want to, if we go to 8 o'clock, we do have a public hearing at 8 o'clock. So. Yes, Richard.
Hi, I'd just like to ask a question. At the meeting about the library, Chris mentioned a negotiation amount which I believe was 2.7 million for land, the building and 60 property spots, and the bond issue motion was 5.8 million. Now, is that 2.7 million included in the 5.8, or is that 2.7 a separate transaction from the 5.8?
Jeff, you want to answer that, or if Chris wants to answer that, but
the 5.8 is inclusive of the proposed or potential purchase of the library,
Okay. Or
of the building, rather.
Yeah, okay. Now, pardon this feeble eye here. It is not too early for Narragansett Town Council to begin the process of establishing a library property committee. The people on this committee should have these skill sets: negotiator, design architect, lawyer, a person knowledgeable in the Rhode Island Library Grant Program. Let me really urge this. No state will partially reimburse any organization unless there is a 100% match between its requirements and the work done. a project engineer, a cost accountant, a librarian, and probably more than one, a municipal planner, a fundraising expert, and someone from the Economic Development Committee. We must not let this committee appointment drift away after the November election. I've said this many times, we'll repeat it. I am worried that this will drift away. This is a very popular issue, and I fear that any attempt to have proper controls over the bonding will cause political concerns, i.e. it won't happen. We should place a hold on the remaining road bonds until the library project is over. We need to make a decision on the expenditure amount for the new library, which I believe was 5.8, and let's not have a repeat of the last school bond issue when it just drifted up and drifted up and drifted up. We must be sure to do it the way the state wants it if we want to qualify for reimbursement. Now, it is disappointing that terms like design, planning, control, and financial management are viewed as if they were contrary to the success of a new library. Remember, these terms need to be applied right now, and it's really not too early to do it now, not after the project is nearing completion, as we did with the last two bond issues. We must remember the disaster of the last school bond. Let's not let the new library be like the last school bond issue.
Thank you, Richard. Stan.
I'd just like to say that there's so many laws out there that I think are kind of it's lousy. It just, you know, it just shouldn't be there. And I was coming down the road at 5 o'clock in the morning the other day. The sun was coming up, and I was coming by the Anawan Cliffs area. There's a 40-mile-an-hour speed issue. There's no cars forward, behind. There's no cars anywhere, and I've got to go 40 miles an hour because that's the law, and I have to do that. And I was creeping up to 42, 45. Finally, I looked at my car has one of these mile per gallon things, and I noticed that I get the maximum miles per gallon. I get 19 miles to gallon if I stay below 40. So that gave me additional incentive to stay below 40 and obey the law. So I obeyed the law, and it was a tough thing to do. And that brings me to the issues here. Narragansett zoning ordinance forbidding occupancy of otherwise suitable resident units by more persons not related by blood, marriage, or adoption is violative of the mandates of due process and equal protection clauses of Article 1, Section 2 of the Rhode Island Constitution. Okay, it seems like the Supreme Court of Rhode Island. Determined the law, or was involved with the law, suggesting that unrelated people, there's a problem with trying to dictate that we can't have unrelated people on our property. And so that brings to mind, here we have our government people going down the road, taking an action on unrelated people, taking an action which is in violation of the Rhode Island Constitution as it stands today. So you don't like the law, so let's just go and ignore the law and progress down this road, which is in violation of the Constitution. Now, I don't mind you going down this road, but let's first overturn this constitutional law that was made by some judge here. A judge did this. And we're going to just ignore the judge. We're going to ignore the law. I can't do that on a speed thing. This is certainly much more important than a speed thing. And number two, all you stood up when you first came and said you were going to obey the laws of the town, the state, and America. You all proclaimed that with your right hand up there. And now you progress to violate the law as you continue to do this unrelated thing. Now, I don't want to do an unrelated thing, but after the law has been changed, so you're not attempting to do something to violate the law as it stands today. That's all I'm asking, okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Stan. Yes, Mr. Traeger.
Good evening, how are you? I made it over. Managed to get my fiberglassing done. I didn't think I was going to be able to make it. I don't really have anything planned. I don't have a speech written. But I brought up the idea of the town manager last time, and I want to mention it again, that I hope a tremendous amount of effort is going to be made to really have a real, live town manager that is going to be here for a number of years, hopefully, and look at the long-term interests of the town. I may be wrong. I was just talking with Mr. Vandermeer for a couple of seconds. I don't have a great deal of knowledge about how these towns are run, but I have gone to a lot of town meetings here, and I've gone to a lot in South Kingstown, and I find it night and day, the difference between the way the meeting at least is run. And I'm not criticizing either one of the meetings. You have your way of doing things, but I also have been I'll use the word victim of the decisions of a town council last year, and I never got an answer that was anywhere close to explaining the reasoning behind the rejection of the sewers in Jerusalem, even after the town manager, not the town engineer, acting town manager now, stated in front of you, or not you though, that's the problem I see. That's why I believe the town manager position is so important, that you are not going to be here permanently. The town councils come and go. I've seen a whole bunch of them. Good and okay, I guess. They're all good, I suppose, in some respects. But when they make decisions that are done behind closed doors, when decisions are made based on discussions with people outside of this meeting, and when somebody's jumped through every hoop there was to jump through, and the majority of the people wanted this, and it wasn't going to cost the town a dime, I know it's fishy. Just turn on the news any day. I listen to a lot of stuff now. C-SPAN, listen to the House of Representatives, listen to the Senate, listen to the committee meetings, and almost everything you turn on today, it's somebody doing the wrong thing behind the scenes, not being out front with what's going on. I don't mind. I can take it. I could be whacked around a little, but I want the truth, and I don't think I get the truth a lot. When something counts for somebody else, and then all of a sudden things can change. I don't know. It's sad. We've got a very sad situation in right now. We're the best country in the world, but we're going behind in almost everything you can think of. Education, That's one thing I'm not going to do.
Thank you.
I'm not going to give you the minute, though, next time.
I know. Thank you. Anyone else? All right, I'm going to move on to our consent agenda, if there's nobody else for public comment. And before entertaining the consent agenda, is there any item on the consent agenda that a council member would like to remove? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. New business, a motion to introduce, read, pass, and accept as a first reading an ordinance and amendment of Chapter 731 of the Code of Ordinances of the Town of Narragansett, Rhode Island, entitled An Ordinance in Relation to Zoning to Approve Various Omnibus Text Amendments.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion. So this is a first reading based on our hearing and from 2 weeks ago, is that correct? And is there any discussion on this? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item number 8 is a motion to approve the contract extension for seasonal sidewalk and public area trash receptacle rubbish removal for the Public Works Department with K. Scott Construction at their quoted bid prices for one additional season ending October 11th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. This item comes from Jeff. Are there any questions for Jeff? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item number 9 is a motion to approve the sponsorship agreement with Citizens Bank for the 2016 Rhode Island Philharmonic Concert Sponsorship.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. This item comes from Steve. Are there any questions for Steve on the concert? Just want to mention that this is a very well put together event. Steve does a great job putting this together around the 4th of July and encourage residents of the town to attend and support this event. It's a lovely event. And thank you, Steve, for all the hard work that you do on that.
Yeah, just one comment maybe. We do this is our 40th year, but what's been happening has been such a well-attended event, but we've been losing more and more money every single year because our donations are pretty much level. Our sponsorships are level and our expenses keep on going up. So if there's anybody else out there that might want to come forward with a sponsorship, there's lots of room for you. So just talk to Steve and we'll put you right down. Thank you.
Yeah, it's probably a good thing to thank the repetition of Citizens Bank over and over again to be there for us. And it's pretty nice of them to do it once again this year. So thank you to Citizens Bank.
If there's no further discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item number 10 is a motion to approve the 2016 contract agreement for the 40th annual concert on the beach with the Rhode Island Philharmonic Orchestra in the amount of $21,300 and authorizes the acting town manager to sign the contract after review by the town solicitor.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Again, this item comes from Steve. It's related to the item number 9, and this is for the orchestra itself. Any questions for Steve? All right, again, thank you again, Steve. And question. Come on, Stan.
Is there any way that we can charge more? Since it's such a great event, and I've been there before, it's certainly worth more than $5, whatever they pay on the parking or that. Is there a possibility that we can charge the appropriate number? You know, it's really worth around $25. Can we increase? Everything is increased this year. Our taxes are increased. Everything increased. Can we increase the amount of money that people pay to enjoy this? So it doesn't all have to fall on a taxpayer. Thanks for citizens. But let's those who are enjoying it show their enjoyment with a little more than a tip. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan.
It's a donation, isn't it?
It's a donation. Steve, do you want to? I mean, thank you, Stan. Any other questions? Yes.
We don't charge.
On that last kind of request, I kind of disagree with that kind of thinking, because a concert of that type, well, if you go to the opera in New York, you're going to pay like anywhere from $100 to $300 to sit there. And a lot of these concerts that go on in town are very expensive. They're $100 and $89 or more than that even. I've lost track of it, just like I lost track of the price of fish is way higher than I've ever thought it would ever be. But anyway, my point is simply this, that this is an opportunity for people that rarely get the opportunity to hear a Philharmonic Orchestra play. And I don't think you should make the amount of money charged to the point where people would not be able to do it.
Steve, can you clarify the charging issue just so that everyone's clear on it?
I believe it's a donation. I remember the Lions doing it.
No. Walk-on is the donation. Right.
Yeah, let.
Hi, good evening. Well, as you know, $10,000 comes from Citizens Bank. They've been doing that for 8 years in a row. We also charge after 5 o'clock, after the beach day is over, we charge $5 for parking, and we also collect donations. Donations we collect in the parking lots and at the beach. So along with that, plus the VIP sales, last year was $17,500. So the concert itself, costs us around $39,000, all of our expenses. That's including labor, staffing, and the Philharmonic, plus the lighting and sound. So
Steve, do you get your help to collect the donations?
That's correct.
Our
staff
goes. At one point, we had the Lions were helping us with that. I didn't know.
Well, our staff is there at the beach. Oh. They're doing the restrooms. They're doing the parking lot.
Sure.
So
no,
for
just
liability
it.
Purposes, we have to, you know, have to maintain the security at the beach. So we are... again, it's coming out of the it's budgeted in the enterprise fund for this concert. We've been doing it for many, many years.
And it's been getting better. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Steve.
You're more than
Thank
welcome.
You for clarifying that. Thank you. Yes, Richard.
Well, we have enough time to get some ancillary revenue. One of them is sweatshirts. I realize in a civilized society, you don't use those words, sweatshirt, wear like sweatshirt, but, you know, like I attended, it may be possible, even though
that's good,
it may be difficult to produce something from this from the point of view of a musical event. I mean, I don't think that perhaps that can be captured, but certainly ancillary revenue, like I attended this, that will get a few dollars, and that can be done. And you sort of, you know, you do the year, and then you just change a year later on, and you can do it the next year. Or you can go on Amazon and said we didn't sell all our 2016s, and maybe people will buy them.
Thank you. As Steve mentioned, the event's paid for out of the Beach Enterprise Fund, and it's something that is a community-focused event that we want to encourage people to attend, and we really wouldn't want to be charging each and every person who is listening on the beach. It's kind of an open air, and we want people to kind of enjoy it in that way. So any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed. Motion approved 4-0. I'm going to ask our stenographer to come up and to set up for our 8 o'clock hearing. And as she's setting up, we'll discuss item number 11. I think will probably be our last one before the public hearings. Item number 11, a motion to approve the 2016 contract agreement for production support services with Bill Brackett Theatrical Productions, LLC, for the 40th annual concert on the beach in the amount of $11,000, and authorizing the acting town manager to sign the contract after review by the town solicitor.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Yes. Right, so I'm... record. Because we need the stenographer for two of the public hearings, we may move one of the public hearings up to reflect that. But our first item is simply a motion to schedule, correct, Dan? So we have a motion to schedule a public hearing to consider various applications from town departments and or local nonprofit organizations for the 2016 Community Development Block Grant Program.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion, what evening are we looking for that, Ann? Okay, so this will be May 2nd at 8 o'clock. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion approved, 4-0.
May 2nd.
All right. A public hearing on a transfer of an alcoholic beverage license from Mainland Narragansett, Rhode Island Incorporated, doing business as Narragansett Grill, 1200 Ocean Road, Plat L, Lot 237, to Carol and Mario Catering Incorporated, Carol A. Santilli, President, 1200 Ocean Road, Plat L, Lot 237.
So moved.
Second.
It'd be a motion to open the public hearing.
Motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion approved, 4-0. If our applicant could step forward. Dawson, our solicitor, will swear you in for the public hearing.
I'm an attorney.
Okay. If you two would raise your right hand, and after you, I swear you in to speak. I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in the matter. Now I'm here before the Narragansett Town Council.
Cal Santilli.
Just speak into the microphone.
Cal Santilli.
Welcome.
Mario L. Santilli.
And my name is Maureen Hobson. I represent the Santillis.
Welcome.
Thank you. I don't know how you wish me to proceed. The Santillis have been in the restaurant business for over 40 years. They've been in their present location in Cranston for over 15 years. They're seeking to make a move to Narragansett, and they're hoping that you will approve the transfer of this liquor license. Mrs. Santilli has brought a copy of her menu. They operate a restaurant that is not a bar type facility. It has seats at a bar, but it's very much a dining experience for excellent food. For my own selfish reasons, I hope you will grant this license because the food is excellent. They stand ready to answer any questions. If you'd like to ask me any questions, please do.
I've heard the same about the food, so.
Yeah. I've heard you had a violinist walking around at the tables playing.
Not yet.
Oh, not yet? Oh, okay. Is that a plan for down here?
They would like the opportunity to...
One at a time into the microphone, just...
It's okay.
Yeah.
They would like the opportunity to do that here. Obviously, the restaurant that's here has 75 seats inside, 24 outside. They are not seeking any type of outdoor entertainment. They were talking about a violin section, you know, a person doing a violin, perhaps a small soloist, but certainly no electronic music or anything of that nature.
Okay, so in that case, I propose that we put in the same qualifications as we have right next door to that piece of property, if the council would allow them to, and I don't know what perhaps Ann or Dawson can bring that up, as far as regulating the hours of entertainment and the type of entertainment in that BA zone.
I'm not sure that we could do anything with the existing restrictions that are on there now unless they've been advertised for public comment. I mean, the transfer of the license just seems like a routine transfer of the license, and no one's going to have an issue with that. But if you want, but if you want restrictions changed, I hate to tell you, but you have to come back after you make an application and they're posted and advertised. It's just the way it's written.
We understand, and you know, had I been involved maybe a little early, we could have done that.
Yeah.
Because certainly the only things we're looking to change would be, like I said, a provision of some indoor music, very low key, and the present situation at the restaurant is that there were six bar seats, and Mr. Santilli would like to increase that to 12,
mm-hmm.
And diminish the number of seats in the restaurant area. So, in other words, we would never exceed the 75, but just where they're seated inside the restaurant, we would like to change,
yeah.
Because people like to dine out. Many people, even from the hotel next door, are alone. They don't like to come in and sit at a table by themselves.
I hear you. Wish we could help you tonight and go through the process, but it hasn't been advertised as such, so.
So could you tell me what's the next available date that could happen?
That would be with the staff to schedule something once it's been formally requested.
Probably June. We have to have two advertisement dates before the next council meeting.
Okay.
So it would be June. But you would have to write a letter to me explaining exactly what you would like.
Okay.
So no just...
excuse me.
Go ahead, ma'am.
No formal application. A letter of request.
And just to remind, to familiarize yourself with the existing restrictions, which you seem to be familiar with. So, but yeah, this is a simple transfer. So, but any other questions?
There were some matters of past due bills. You're going to take care of all that.
Mr. Durkin's going to take care of those as part of our arrangement.
I'm done. That's fine.
Good.
All right. Well, welcome. Thank you. And if we may call you back up if we have any additional questions.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone else wish to testify as part of the public hearing on this transfer? All right. So I'll take a motion then to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. And so I'll be looking for a motion on the particular request for the transfer.
I would motion that we approve the transfer subject to all state and local regulations.
Second.
Discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Welcome and congratulations.
Congratulations. Good luck. Good luck.
We're going to be moving something.
Yeah, forward. So what I'll do is I'll just entertain a motion to move up a public hearing for text revision of the definitions of building coverage and site coverage in the zoning ordinance to our next item. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, discussion. We're simply doing this because the stenographer is required for this particular hearing, so we want to make sure that we use her time wisely and our time wisely. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Is there a motion to open a public hearing for text revision of the definitions of building coverage and site coverage in the zoning ordinance?
Motion.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Mike and Terry, please.
Good evening.
Welcome.
Thank you. Good to be here. The planning board has been involved in a number of issues with staff relative to zoning ordinances. We presented, I believe, at the last meeting, the omnibus regulations, which you just voted on your first reading, or your second, I think your first reading. This is, and as part of this process, we have called out 5, 6, 7 other issues that we think need to be addressed. We're going to bring them back to you, probably one at a time or two at a time, over as we vet these. And we also are undergoing an internal process with the planning board from time to time, having meetings on trying to streamline certain aspects of the process for applicants so that they can reasonably adjudicate their business with us and then onto the zoning board. So this is the second item relative to this, and Michael is going to talk about the technical aspects, if you just bear with me for a couple minutes in terms of what the process was. This involves lot coverage, site coverage, building coverage, and what gets counted and what doesn't get counted. And we have seen over time a number of cases in which, for example, decks, open decks, have been counted towards the lot coverage. And really, out of abundance of caution in terms of the ordinance for controlling runoff or making sure there's not too much runoff and that it's controlled. But when we see cases of open decks that accept water, we think sometimes that people are burdened by this, and we've looked for ways to try to grant people some exemptions from this if it's reasonable. And so the board has spent a great deal of time in this. Let me tell you, and Michael can give you the history of this, but we have done a similar thing with Breakwater Village, and it seemed to have worked well. People have gotten, under reasonable circumstances, certain exceptions for expanding their decks. And so the planning board took this particular matter under advisement for, I would say, 3 or 4 different separate meetings. We spent a lot of time with this. We have the proposal that we're bringing to you, the planning board unanimously supports. We feel it's a reasonable accommodation. We also looked at additional scenarios in which there was a more expansive or a more open exemption. And I have to tell you, the planning board is equally unanimously opposed to anything beyond this. We really feel strongly that this is a reasonable thing given all the cases that we see over time. And I just want to let you know we're 4-square against expanding this beyond this point. If the council, after vetting this themselves, feel that they want to make other revisions, we would respectfully ask that you send it back to us with the specific revisions that you may want to look at so that we can vet that. We spend a lot of time on this. And again, I'll let Michael get into the whole area of swimming pools and the mitigation systems. But as it relates to the deck, please understand this exception, which allows for a 15% expansion. If someone is close to or at the lot coverage, they can get, without coming through the board, a 15% expansion of a deck of the footprint of the existing building, correct? Of the footprint, 15% of that. But there are conditions. One is there's no roof on these decks. These decks, again, because of the runoff issue, have to be open, have to accept water. They also come with the requirement that the applicant be in conformance with the other dimensional regulations of the zone. So if there are setback issues already, or if this creates setback issues, then they do have to come back to the boards, okay? But this is someone who is within conformity of the other dimensional relief and would just like to expand the deck, and that currently that expansion would require it to go over the lot coverage. We think this is a reasonable accommodation, and we would really like the council's opinion on this because some people may think it's too expansive, but again, not to overstate what I've already said, but I just want to make sure the board looked at other scenarios, and Michael's going to show you those. We really felt they were too excessive. Okay, we're very concerned about an unbridled or an unrestricted expansion of the lot coverage. It's been characterized that people want a deck, they should get a deck. Remember, and I know I've said this in front of you before, the reason people are in front of the planning board is because they want a variance. They want to exceed. They want to go in excess of what the ordinance allows. So it's not fair to characterize a burden, I think, put on applicants and residents to go back and forth with the boards because the overwhelming majority of decks are constructed with a permit because they're within the ordinance. These are situations in which people want to exceed what's allowed. Given that, we still think there's situations where we think people were unduly burdened, and we think this is a reasonable accommodation. So there are other aspects, and the distinction between building coverage and site coverage is something hopefully Michael can explain because I can't explain it, but I just wanted to give you the high level of what the board felt, and then let Michael explain the technical aspects. So here to answer any questions, and again, respectfully ask that if you really want to go beyond what we're requesting, we'd like to vet whatever before you make a final decision. Thank you.
Terry?
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. No, you had, I thought that I saw a 10% on the Breakwater Village.
10% is Breakwater.
This is not going to change that, is
no.
it? Okay.
And we first considered the 10% for this and felt it wasn't enough. It was
No, understood.
It was
too I just
minimal,
didn't know if it went the other way.
For Breakwater. Yep.
No. Nope.
All right, now for the technical boring stuff.
And Mike, in that discussion, if it's possible to separate the deck versus pool storylines, because they sometimes get meshed together, but
yeah.
Okay.
Okay. No, I got it right here. I'm sorry, this is the opening panel for the omnibus ordinance, so I don't even need to go through this. This is not a housekeeping item, so that's why we're here on a separate hearing. All right, so the primary item for discussion tonight is building coverage, but the second item is site coverage. I'll get to that, but I've got some examples here I'd like to show you on building coverage. What you're looking at on the screen shows text in three different colors. The white text is the current definition, and as you can see, we're adding some text in yellow. So the current definition is staying, it's not. The language that is there is not changing, but we're adding clarity by adding some specificity. So, and what we're doing is providing two levels of exempted items. The first sentence in the yellow identifies exempted items we would suggest by right, and then the latter sentence is exempted items we would suggest that are conditional. So. What we've said in the first sentence, notwithstanding the above structural components installed as part of a runoff or erosion control system and or the wetted surface of an in-ground or above-ground pool shall not be counted in the calculation. The reason for that is that in both cases, we're dealing with water. The pool acts as a containment. So when rain hits a pool, it just is absorbed. When rain, so it doesn't run anywhere. The second half of this, the idea of the erosion control mitigation system, the reason that's in there is because we don't want to penalize people on their lot coverage, their building coverage, for elements that they're adding to the site that's going to help to manage stormwater runoff. And we know in this town, we have high water tables, and we have to manage that. We've got a very robust stormwater management regulation. So we felt as though penalizing someone for the structural components of a stormwater management device is kind of ineffective. So we want to let those individuals know that a stormwater management device would just be exempt. So we would consider those exempted by right. The last sentence speaks to an issue with sun decks. And I want to preface this by saying this has to do with properties where there's either an existing building or a proposed building that is intended to come right up to or meet the maximum lot coverage. In an R10 zone, the maximum lot coverage, the maximum building coverage is 25%. In an R20, it's 20%. So what we're trying to do with the last sentence is to state that if someone is at that maximum or very near to it, but they want to add a sun deck, or they want to expand a very small sun deck into a somewhat larger one, that there could be some latitude allowed. So what we say here is where the structural improvements on site have met but not exceeded, or are proposed to meet but not exceed the maximum allowance regulated in section 6.4 or 6.5, that has to do with the coverage maximum I just mentioned. Then, non-roofed sun decks totaling up to 15% of the adjacent residential unit's overall footprint shall be exempt. So if the building is at 25% of, if it's at the 25% maximum in an R10, that means it has a 2,500 square foot footprint. And 15% of that is, I can't remember the number, but I'm going to show you the graphics. And those numbers are on that. Excuse me.
Sorry. We wanted to mention the R10 and the R20.
Yes.
Okay. And the other thing was the ordinance, does it have to be modified to reflect no other dimensional relief? I know
right.
I mentioned it.
Okay. Okay, you're gonna handle those two items on the fly. This is example number one, and it's actually based on a substandard lot of record. As you can see in the top left corner, it states that the lots in question are 5,000 square foot lots. We're showing you this because we have a lot of these in town. They were platted and recorded many years ago before we had R10 zoning. What you're looking at on the left-hand side, a lot furthest to the left, is what we allow today. We allow 1,250 square feet because it's not 10,000, it's 5,000 square feet. 1,250 square feet is 25% of the lot. We do not allow, if you had a 1,250 square foot house, you'd not be allowed a sun deck. The proposal, as supported by the planning board, is the next lot over. That shows what would happen with a 1,250 square foot building maxed out on a 5,000 square foot lot. You'd be allowed 188 square feet of sun deck. If you went to 20% or 25% exemption, again, the building, the house is the same size, but the exemption increases to 250 square feet or 313. Keep in mind, you also have to allow 600 square feet of parking for what we're estimating would be a three-bedroom house. Now, in the more standard circumstance, this is a 10,000 square foot lot. We left off the existing situation, which means if you had a 2,500 square foot building, you'd have no allowance for a sun deck at all. But in the proposal, the property on the far left would allow for 375 square feet of sun deck that would be exempted. Again, Mr. Fleming noted that would be with the conditions that you don't need any other form of relief, no height relief, no setback relief, no needs for relief from the coastal or wetland overlay. Again, the 20% option would bring you up to 500 square feet of decking, and the 25% option would bring you up to the 625 square foot allowance. Those last two examples and the other one that you saw previous were not supported by the planning board. The planning board supports the 15%. And as you mentioned, as Mr. Rinaldi noted, we already have an allowance similar to this in Breakwater Village. That's a very densely developed area, and we allow up to 10% exemption for sun decks. It's been working quite well. It's been in place for 6 years now. And we have one more example. This is in an R20 zone where you are allowed 20% coverage. And if you had a 4,000 square foot building, which is a fairly large house, you'd be allowed 600 square feet of sun deck exempted. The 20% and 25% option would bring you up to 800 or 1,000 square feet of decking. Again, the planning board did not support the 20 or the 25% allowance. The two items that Mr. Fleming brought up just a minute ago were that one thing we didn't write into the ordinance but was discussed at the planning board was revising this language slightly to make note that we would limit this exemption to the R10 and R20s only. When you get to R40, which is an acre, or R80, which is 2 acres, there's just so much land there that it doesn't seem appropriate to even consider any form of exemption. And that was discussed but not written into the draft ordinance. The other item was other dimensional relief, which I've already covered. So the last thing is to speak about site coverage. And the question that comes to most people's mind is, what's the difference between building coverage and site coverage? It's a great question. I spent a little bit of time reviewing the ordinance and actually reviewing the history of the ordinance. Building coverage has been in the ordinance for many, many years. I went back into to the 70s. And it's always been in the code. It goes right to the dimensional regulations that we have in Section 6, the dimensional regulations for lot area, frontage width, setbacks. Site coverage has always been in that table of regulations for 30, 40 years. What wasn't in the ordinance was, that was building coverage. Were you all correcting
first
in your minds for me there? I apologize. Building coverage is the one that's been in the ordinance for a long time. I stand corrected. Site coverage was added in 1987 with the five overlay districts. The freshwater wetlands overlay, the coastal overlay, the high water table overlay, the floodplain overlay, and the steep slope overlay. When we added all those overlay environmental ordinances, it was deemed necessary to put in a new definition, site coverage, double check my notes, to make certain that people understood how important it is that we know exactly what we're calculating our stormwater analysis against. And with all of those, except for, all five of those overlays, stormwater management has to be addressed. So we've changed the language here by taking the original language, which is in white up there, percentage of lot area covered by the building area, plus covered porches, walkways, driveways, parking areas, and other concrete, asphalt, or other structures, or impervious surfaces that do not absorb stormwater. And we've refined that to, we took out actually the word open porches, where it says covered porches, we took out open and we put in covered. So we wanted to make sure that impervious surfaces are the focus of this definition, and that's why we added the language below. Notwithstanding the above, non-roofed open sun decks and stairways, which typically exterior stairways do not have risers, so water can run off them, shall not be included in this classification, but will be counted toward building coverage in accordance with that definition. So we're trying to clarify this definition for the implementation of Chapter 4, the environmental layer overlays. It sounds a lot like the previous one, but the other one has to do with massing. This one has to do with the stormwater management related to Chapter 4. I know that there's a lot of overlap in those thoughts, and it's a little bit to assimilate, but those are the proposals that we've made. We believe that the building inspector will have a much better set of rules to implement on building coverage with this change. We feel the engineering division will have a much better handle on what they are reviewing when they receive stormwater calculations for future developments with the revision of the site coverage. And with that, I will end my presentation. Any questions you have, I'll be happy to address.
Thank you, Mike. Any questions for Mike? All right, does anyone from the public want to speak, testify on and during this public hearing? Steve.
Straight tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, and matter now I'm hearing for the Narragansett Town Council.
I do.
So it's an your name for
okay. Stephen Ferrandi, F-E-R-R-A-N-D-I, last name. I live at 44 Sylvan Road. Thank you. Thank you, Council. I just had a few questions on the issue. It kind of seems like we're taking a more of a simple definitions that we had, and with kind of breaking them down a little more, trying to refine things. And I was just wondering, what the genesis is. Is the building inspector that burden where people are coming in and getting turned away because they can't get a pool permit because of this?
I think, yeah, maybe Terry and the planning board that want to address.
See if I
may
have a question. I'll share the microphone.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, actually, we see more than just a few applications for swimming pools or sun deck expansions where property might have been built 20 or 30 years ago and was built right up to the building coverage max, And as times have changed over the years, more and more people have chosen to seek to build in-ground pools. So they find themselves going to the zoning board for something as simple as a pool. The genesis and the general objective here is to take some of the simpler projects that won't have a major impact on surrounding areas off the zoning board's docket so that they can focus more attention on the more difficult, complex ones.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I just had a couple other observations about it. Now, you say that this is only going to be in the smaller zones, R5 and R10,000, and a bigger zone is not going to have the same exemption?
10 and 20.
10 and 20, that's it? Isn't that kind of like spot zoning?
No, because it includes all of R.
It includes all of R10s and all of R20s.
Yeah. Well, I just kind of wary that, you know, this is going to be for quite a few different zones out there, and it might create some red herrings here and there with the different issues that come up. That's my observation. I mean, I understand that it's been thought out, and it's been known that, you know, we're already kind of making a little exemption to go to this level. But a lot of this relief can be done at the zoning board now, and there's really no guarantee that if someone goes to these regulations and they want more, they still could end up in the zoning board. So this is just an observation that I have to see. You know, we're kind of like an incremental creep of different things that we think might solve the problem, and hopefully they will. But, you know, that doesn't stop anyone from wanting to do something more after that. And, you know, I just don't think the zoning should be based on what the lots we have left in town that might be for one use or the other. It sounds a little like selective zoning. That's the way I look at it. But I understand a lot of time and detail went in it. And, Mike, I appreciate all the work you did. I understand that. I just a little leery of it, that's all.
Well, Steve, it's been my observation that somebody owns a straight ranch or something, wants to put a little deck on their house, all right? It's going to cost them $3,000-$4,000. They got to go through the planning. In some cases, some people hire attorneys to put a little deck on their house. All this is just a little relief. It's going to free up the docket for the planning and zoning. It's not a big encroachment. To me, it's a property rights issue. I think we're just, you know, a 1,000-square-foot house, talking about a 10 by 15 deck.
No, I understand.
I mean, it's not.
I understand the intent of it. I'm just kind of leery of any time a zone is changed and it's good for the whole town. Right. A lot of small properties, you know, and everybody, right. This changes and maybe right. People, they can't understand why, you know, the right. Deck's so close or something else like that. So I just, there's a lot of other things to be considered right. With it. But I understand, you know, at some point there's relief, but there's also a variance process too. So,
right.
I mean, if our zoning right. Board is that busy that we can't have the meetings, then I could say we have a failed process.
Right.
You know, if Tony said, listen, it's inundating the zoning board because we have too many people that want an extra deck or make the deck bigger, then I could say. But, you know, there is other processes that can be
used. Well, let's take the pool. Let's take the pool scenario. I mean, the reason the pool was in there, because for some reason, some wizard along the way didn't feel that a pool can hold rainwater. So...
No, I understand.
This is an ordinance that needed to go many years ago. So this is way overdue. There's a couple other things that are going to come up this year that I'm trying to push that just make things easier on homeowners to work on their properties so they're not cooling their heels in the hallway over here in planning or zoning.
Right.
And have to hire an attorney. Good God.
I know. I mean, there is a process. I mean, as far as the pool, I mean, the pool really, to me, it should be considered as part of the coverage. I mean,
sure. I wish you were in planning 20 years ago.
So, Steve, if you could kind of give your testimony, then the council will.
That's fine. I'm all set. I just was going to say one other thing. There's only one person that I know that could walk on water, and we all know who that was. So that's. I don't understand why that can't be part of the building coverage. So I'll end with that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Yes, Terry.
To Steve's point, we were very concerned about the massing. That's why the no other dimensional relief is very important here, right? Because we do get, you know, we call it decks and sheds, part of our agenda, right? These are the site reviews where people come in. And a lot of times the neighbors are very upset because there's massing, because the deck encroaches. That's why it's very important that the setbacks, if the setbacks are violated or compromised at all, they have to come through the boards for approval, okay? So it's still within the building envelope, okay?
Terry, you got one question, please? Typically, if someone comes to you, is maxed out on his 25% lot coverage, and is asking for relief to build a small deck off to the side of their house, does the planning board measuring up against the comprehensive plan typically okay that, as long as all the setbacks, under normal circumstances, would that be normally passed anyway?
Again, we've seen these, Chris, and because it's an open deck and because big part of the reason for the lot coverage is runoff, and that can accept water. It's not a big concern from that part. So yes, if the setbacks aren't compromised, if people aren't looming over their neighbors, or there aren't other dimensional reliefs in terms of height and those kinds of things, we generally do.
So historically, you've approved them.
I'll tell you, we do look askance at people who build a new house and they build it to the lot coverage and come in a year later and
look for a
deck, because you would think the planning would, in their own mind, would have taken that into account.
You'll see that soon, though.
So there's always those situations which you try to deal with as well as we can. But, you know, we've just seen, I'll tell you, we've seen a number of cases which I think are going to be addressed to a large degree by this ordinance and have been in Breakwater, where we see the reasons why they're in front of us. We see the circumstances of the application, and we look at each other and say, this is really not that big a deal. But when it does exceed the setbacks, when it starts to compromise the neighbor's privacy, that's a whole different issue, and we absolutely need to have those come back through both boards, okay?
Thank you. Mr. Traeger.
Try hard. Yes.
You're now under oath. State your name.
Okay. Bob Traeger, T-R-A-G-E-R. This isn't a, let's still get to the oath, I guess. Anyway, I just wanted to say I appreciate your comments about taking, that's what I'm hoping a person does on a council. Think about what's going to help the people, make life easier for them, and take unnecessary burdens off their shoulders. And I appreciate that. I appreciate the little emotion you showed, too. Keep it up.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? All right, so we can move to close the hearing. Susan's not here. We could leave it open and have her review the transcript. I don't know what you guys want to do with that.
That would make a reading, so I'll move to close.
Second.
Okay. Motion to close the public hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. And is there a motion regarding the item?
Motion approved as presented.
Second.
All right. Discussion? So I understand the rationale behind this, but I would have liked a little more time to kind of go over some of those. I haven't really felt I've seen a lot of it myself. So I understand the sentiment behind it, but I guess Steve Ferrandi made some points that I would be concerned about in terms of, I don't know how big of a problem it is. I guess that's that piece, and Mike did talk about that. You know, that he's gotten some people coming forward, you know, so, but that's just my sentiment.
Mike,
what do you guys think?
I got a question. Mike, out of all the planning and zoning meetings, how much of the calendar is taken up by some guy wanting to put a 10 by 15, 10 by 20 deck on his house?
That's a hard thing to answer in
15%, 10%?
If I had to kind of boil down 10 years worth of experience here, probably in the 10 to 15% range.
Okay.
Some years it's much higher and we have a big you know, a lot.
It's a big run
on
decks.
Will go months without having a single one, but
right.
10 to 15%.
Right. I mean, I think this is a good thing. It'll give the ability to introduce the great outdoors to a bunch of homeowners who couldn't or who didn't want to hire an attorney or just go pull a permit, build a deck, and have a cookout. Doesn't get any better than that.
I just have to respect the unanimous decision of the planning from both ends, from not going more and from increasing it from the 10% that Breakwater Village has. I think that all of the time that you put into it, I appreciate, and I'm 100% for it. Yeah.
This was initially proposed back in October, right?
Yeah. We started researching it back last summer, but yeah.
Right, right. It was supposed to have the first reading back in October, if I remember correctly. I'm only good. I got a shelf life till November here. We got to get this thing.
It was part of the omnibus ordinance.
Right.
That's on me, Councilman, because
right. Yeah, I know.
I kept insisting that we have as many hearings as we needed to make sure we're comfortable with it. Okay.
Sure.
Yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? No. Motion approved 3-1. Our next item is a public hearing on the Town of Narragansett fiscal year 2016 budget. Oh, before that, a motion to receive and place on file the recommendation from the Planning Board.
Motion.
This is for
second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. All right. Next item is a public hearing on the Town of Narragansett fiscal year 2016-17 budget. What I'm going to do is have Jeff and Laura update us on where we are with the budget. This is our second public hearing. Our first public hearing was focused on the school budget, and we've had our budget work sessions over the last week where we've been making some modifications. So. Jeff, you and Laura, I'm going to turn it over to.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mike has got the PowerPoint up, and it's the same one that I've delivered to you before the meeting. Back on March 16th, when I presented my budget to you, we were looking at a budget that required a tax levy of $49,052,882, second line from the top there. That represented a property tax increase of $760,523, or 1.6%. And that included level funding the school appropriation at that time at $24,237,297. That same day, on March 16th, the school committee adopted their budget, which reflected a town appropriation of $25,241,185. They subsequently revised that by deleting $93,000 from the capital program, and it left what I'm referring to is the delta, the difference between the level funding that I had proposed and what the school committee adopted, of $910,888. And that's essentially where we went into the work sessions with. And as you noted, Matt, we had work sessions last week on Monday with the school committee and on Tuesday and Thursday with the senior management team. There was quite a bit of discussion about how to find some middle ground or how to make this budget work within the confines of what we believe the council's directives were to Pam in particular and then to Laura and I about keeping things within 2%. So a couple of the things that we looked at, thanks, Laura, was on the school side to assign the school CIP for HVAC. There's currently $313,500 in the 2015-16 budget, and it's as a placeholder because the HVAC project is not scheduled to start until 17-18. So the thought was to assign that money to the capital project for 16 and 17, and then decrease the school bus CIP from $200,000 to $100,000. That brings the new school appropriation delta, so-called, down to $497,388. On the town side, we noted during the work sessions that we had to increase the library's budget by $12,921 to meet the state-required maintenance of effort, and that's necessary in order to get state library funding. There was a request by the town council to increase the town council's budget for boards and commissions recognition of $6,000. To offset those two, we proposed increasing the municipal court revenue by $18,921. We also proposed to increase the vehicle maintenance revenue for the school buses by $120,000, and I'll get into the reason for that in just a second. And then the last change on the town side was we recommended eliminating a proposed enhanced basketball program for Parks and Rec for $30,000. So the net changes were $150,000. Now, to work towards a tax levy change of 1.9%, we've presented this summary to you. The original proposal was $48,439,721. We added $120,000 in revenue for the vehicle maintenance. We eliminated the Parks and Rec basketball program of $30,000. We increased the school transfer by $497,388, and that was that delta that I described on the previous slide. We're increasing the use of fund balance on the town side by $100,000, and we're decreasing the pension contribution by $100,000. That brings us to a new delta of $908,061, or a tax levy increase of 1.9%. Now, to explain how we got there and why we think this works, the vehicle maintenance revenue reflects booking school bus maintenance revenue, which is currently carried as an expense on the school budget, as a revenue within the town budget. We had not included that within the manager's March 16th proposed budget, so it's $120,000 of revenue that would move from the school into the town side. Again, it's already booked on the school side, so we don't have to add it to them, but it had not been booked on our side. We've proposed to eliminate the proposed new basketball program, which would be a straight $30,000 reduction from the March 16th budget. And then assigning the $313,500 from the school HVAC capital project reflects the timing of the project. Those funds will not be needed until 2017 and 18. So the $313,500 can be used for other school capital needs in 16-17, and the decision on how to fund the HVAC project can be made as part of the 17-18 budget development process next year.
Jeff, just a clarification, the $30,000 on the basketball program, it's not changing the existing programs. The Parks and Rec director had a proposal for a traveling team expansion of the program, which we're really not ready to implement. So that's why, is that fair to say?
That's correct. That would have been a new program that we have proposed to eliminate. The decrease of $100,000 from the school bus replacement capital program will still leave the school with $100,000 to lease five new buses in 16-17. If you remember, there was discussions with the Capital Reserve Committee and the school committee about the desire and need to replace nine of the oldest buses that were all purchased in 1 year. The school is, and Superintendent Cipolla is here and can speak to this as well, but the school is proposing to purchase three buses during this current fiscal year, lease five more during 16-17 with the $100,000 that we've left in the budget. So that will allow them to replace eight of the nine oldest buses during 2016. The pension contribution proposed within the town manager's budget on March 16th was estimated at 104% of the annual required contribution, or the ARC. And it was quite a bit of discussion at the work sessions about how we got there and what this number actually means. That number is calculated by a percentage of payroll, so it's not a fixed number. But within a very small range, it becomes a fluid number. We believe that we can decrease the ARC for 16 and 17 by 100,000, as mentioned earlier, but we can still meet the ARC at 100%. My original budget proposal on March 16th proposed using $430,262 from the town's undesignated fund balance, which would leave us slightly less than 8 million, or 13%. We're proposing to use an additional 100,000 for 1617, which will still leave us within the ranges set by the town council policy. So when you combine all of the above items, we end up with a proposed tax levy increase of 1.9%, or roughly 20 cents per thousand on the residential property rate. That's all I have for my presentation, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Any questions from the council?
Excuse me one second. Laura has advised me that the rate per thousand will probably end up around 16 or 17 cents once we're done making the final adjustments on the assessed valuations.
So it's going to go lower.
So it'll be a little lower than what I had prepared earlier today. This is still kind of a moving target. But
you want another week or so to try to get it lower? Or?
Well, I think it's probably as low as it's going to go right now unless you change something. But between 16 and 17 cents per thousand on the residential property rate.
Just want to thank you for a very job well done. Thank you, both of you. All departments. Thank you.
And so the council, we have the public hearings on the budget, which we're going to call on people to come forward. The council's also had discussion about an additional work session, and we're trying to schedule that. It looks like that will be on April 27th, but we're not sure, because what we would do is receive input tonight and then have a work session prior to the first reading of the budget if there's any changes, so that everybody understands kind of where we are procedurally on that. So with that being said, again, I was very happy that the town, acting town manager and Pam had really, the directive of the council was to keep the taxes, you know, don't go to that 4%, keep our taxes as low as possible. We had a 1.6% increase that was first put forward by them. My goal is to see if we can still get back down to the 1.6. And that being said, we want to hear what people, unless any council member wants to speak first, otherwise we're going to go to, any thoughts before we go to the? Okay. All right. Anyone on the budget? Stan.
As you know, I attended some work sessions to try and figure this out. Of course, I'm not a financial guru, so if I misspeak at all, please interrupt me and correct me. I appreciate that. First, I want to say is, after going to the work sessions, I got to say that the town staff is really the most professional group that I've heard speak in a long time. I was really impressed with their and Laura's guide, all the guidance and how they handled the whole situation. It's a real plus, and it was really good to hear something I can almost understand. However, I have to say I have some disagreements, not with them. What they did was fantastic, but with what you as council persons tried to coax and change here. Like there was one comment about a calculation was made that the revenues was going to be about a $200,000 shortfall in revenues. Therefore, they didn't want to support the 1.6%. And I say, and what I heard was that the town building inspector said he couldn't believe the number of permits and the improvements to houses and the number of, it just seems that he was going to have a lot of extra assessments possible. So you're going to have a lot more increase than you see. So that might be there to cover this so-called shortfall, and therefore 1.6 really should be zero. And of course that goes along with the debt issue. The debt issue, what I heard was we have between 10 and 16.6% possibility. Well, you know, because we have such a fantastic staff, I believe that they're right on top of this, and we should be closer to that 10%. We don't have to be 13%. We can get closer because we have a good staff in charge of this thing. And I know it's fluid, but I think we can get down lower, especially since the assessments may be higher because of the buildings. Then I heard, of course, the idea of going after pension monies, which Jeff has done. I know that's 104%, but we're still. What I also read in the was that there already is a reduction in OPEB, other post-employment benefits, by $125,595. So here we are already raiding the pension. We had an agreement to do something about the pension. We had dollars, millions of dollars, and we're already on the road to start taking some away from the pensions to fund schools or whatever. Then I heard about compromise. We want to compromise. And I'm saying, I'm not so sure compromise is needed. Let's say if you tell the school we want to compromise, they want $1 million, and they're going to, next year they're going to ask for $2 million because they figure you're going to compromise down to $1 million. So even to put it out there that you're going to compromise causes the people to double their requests in anticipation of compromise. So I don't think compromise is really right there. Then I heard another councilman says, he asked the staff, are you comfortable with the numbers? And I like that, because you know that's engaging the staff. Let's ask the experts, they're the experts. Are you comfortable with these numbers? And I say I would like to, especially Jeff's is so good at running the operation, I'd like to make him a little uncomfortable. Huh? Let's get it down to zero and see what he comes up with. So I'm not so sure that I want, you know, I'm glad to know what he's comfortable with, but I think at this situation, when we have almost an $8 million surplus hanging out there somewhere, to come down a little bit at 0%, it seems that this 1.6 or 1.9 was a target set out there, not necessarily a need based on our surplus, if you will.
Thank you, Stan. We're going
to. You know, I have it on here, and I'll give it to you, but you know, I don't think there's a lot of people back there. Just let me a few more minutes.
No, I'm going to let others come up, and we'll see what the time is, Stan. Thank you.
Yeah, I understand.
I understand, too. So,
yeah.
Yes,
well,
Richard.
Let me.
Stan, you can come back up if we have time. Thank you.
Let me give you this piece of paper, which at least outlines many more things that I have to say, as
please
well as
bring
I
it
send
up.
An email.
Bring it to
so
Ann,
I'll
please.
Bring it to Ann.
Thank you.
At least if you won't allow me to speak anymore,
Stan,
I will at least have had some effort put into this thing.
Thank you, Stan.
Because there is a lot more issues with surpluses and vehicles. You know, there's a lot more issues where we can find money to not to have a 0% increase. And I think Jeff is the man to do it. Thank you.
Richard.
Hi, this is just a very general comment because I was not at that meeting, but it goes back to lease purchase, and obviously in the first year, a lease is generally much cheaper than a purchase, and that's all I can say about that. But lease payables, if it meets the accounting definition, is a long-term debt. Now, I'm not prepared to say it is in this case because I do not know the terms of the lease, but lease payables are long-term debt. And if it were a material amount, which I don't know it is or not, it is long-term debt. So please don't forget this when you're looking at long-term debt. Lease payable is a long-term debt according to accounting rules.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? Stan, if you go ahead. Just finish the comments that you were.
Thank you very much. Appreciate you giving me a chance, since there's nobody else that seems to be concerned about money. I understand this is a rich town with millionaires here and a lot of rich kids here, therefore nobody participates. However, I have a tenant who came over and gave me only $625 and says, please don't evict me. I don't have the last $30 to give you. So there is many people out there that are hurting out there, and I speak for those. I speak for the people who are not the millionaires and the rich kids.
Stanley.
I'll do the best I can.
Stanley, where'd the guy get the idea that you're going to evict them over $30?
my wife is a pretty tough collector of rents.
Okay.
You know, and what happens is we let somebody go on $300, and there was one old man who got to $6,000. You know?
I wish we had the stenographer here.
It does happen. You know,
but Stanley, I think the crux of your statements have been, and you've sent us an email about it, is that we really should take it from the fund balance. I mean, to summarize what your solution is for the budget is you don't think we should have lowered the pension amount, we shouldn't fund the schools, add to theirs, and you shouldn't give the, we should give a flat allocation to the school.
I'm not
is that correct?
Stan, I'm not taking away from the school.
But Stan, to get to zero, you would go to the fund balance. Is that correct? I want to summarize.
Yeah, fund balances are the main target is the fund balance.
Thank you. But we have that. We understand that, and we get it.
I'd like to look at the numbers. I mean, according to Jeff's thing on a tube, the fund balance of the school was $1.8 million. And then the beach was $1 million. The town was, well, he's got it down to $7 million. We have a large balance out there, a large balance. And I'm happy with that because that means we're solid. However, that means we can come in with 0% increase and not really have a problem. Now, if you want to stop picking little things, I agree with Councilman Murray there, is $50,000 on the towers, $50,000 on these out there, they should be self-supporting. There's another $100,000 out there that does not have to happen. And then when I look at buses, I know there's a big discussion on buses, but you know, a bus is a commercial vehicle, they should be able to go 500,000 miles. We should have, check the routes a little more to make sure that we fill these buses. Maybe we could just rehab the bus with new upholstery and paint. These are different options that you can see in the past. Same thing, we had a fire truck that was 30 years old. So, I mean, we could look at these vehicles. Then I look at a $6,000 meal. Well, I know it's only $6,000, but we could have a potluck supper out there with some grills down at sunset, and we could save on that a $6,000. All these areas. And then we look at the Johnny Cake Center. My family ended up giving over $1,000 in donations to Johnny Cake, but now you decide that you want to give special appropriations that don't necessarily have to happen. You know, it's a series of issues out there that again, I'll repeat it again. If Kransky could do it 4 out of the last 5 years, I think we can. I think we can do that. And looking at the individual dollars, yes, the fund balances are the primary concern. I don't like the school and the beach even can have their fund balances here, so we could use them for debt, number one. Number two, have we really looked at the debt savings? We are holding $8-9 million to save 0.5% or 1% on some kind of debt in the future. What is the actual savings that we occur due to our debt issues based on having to have all this money sitting around?
All right, thank you, Stan. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you for letting me speak.
Of course, thank you.
I just hope that you would consider next time a target of 0%. We saw a target of 0%. And I heard, it's only $50. It's only $50, okay? In 10 years, it's $500. 20 years, it's $1,000 or more. $1,000. Just when somebody's getting ready to retire, that the bill is higher by $1,000 or more. It adds up, and we have to stop it. And I think.
Thank you, Stan.
Thank you.
To address the issues with the different targets, this is my fourth budget, and many times the town budget has come in. In my recollection, in for a tax raise between 3.5 to 4.0. So as there's been an evolution and as the council has gave that direction to get a lower overall tax when we sat with Pam early on in this process, so that direction came from the council, came from the people, right, asking for that stricter approach to the tax increase. So by the same token, there are a lot of different other things that we have to think about. We can't totally deplete our fund balance. I mean, we can, but I would like not to totally deplete our fund balance. I would like us to fund our pension at a reasonable rate. I'd like to give allocation to the schools after they present to us. That's commensurate with what they need, but we probably can't go all the way to the amount requested, realizing the school committee is independently elected and has their role to play. It was a series of compromises, but the direction at the beginning was very clear to come in at a lower starting point, Tom.
Matt, if you will.
Yeah. Jeff, did you want to
speak? Yeah, I just have a couple of observations following up on Stanley and Richard's comments, just to clarify a couple of things. We do understand that leasing the school buses does count as debt. It's typically a five-year lease for them, but we do realize that. A couple of the things that Stan mentioned, the $50,000 for the towers, $50,000 for the land trust. The $50,000 for the land trust is an annual contribution that's been in the code of ordinances since 1986, I believe. So if the council were to wish to suspend that, you'd actually have to change the code of ordinances. You'd have to have two readings and advertise it to change that. The $50,000 for the towers is, again, a typical annual contribution to them. And it's made this year in lieu of any other capital contribution. They also have a pending Champlin grant application that they are preparing, and they need the $50,000 for matching fund. The Champlin grant is about three times that. It's about $150,000, but the towers would need to put up $50,000 as a match. And so that would be to fund their capital improvement program for the next couple of years. So I would respectfully suggest that that would not be a place to take the money from, otherwise we'll forfeit that grant. And the last piece on the fund balance, it's very tempting to say, yeah, let's grab the fund balance now and return a budget to you of 0%. The problem with it is very simple, and it's similar to what the school committee is facing and what they're going to face next year. If you use your fund balance to balance the budget this year, and next year you want to level fund everything, where are you starting from? You're starting at a lesser place. Let's just take a number, for example. Say that I propose to use $1 million of fund balance and get this budget down to 0.5% for you. Next year comes along, you want the town manager to level fund the budget or to come close to level fund it. You've already used fund balance this year to level fund it. You haven't replaced it. If you do that 2, 3, 4 years in a row, you will rapidly get below that range that the council has set for allowable fund balance. The only right way that fund balance increases is that you have a surplus at the end of the year, or you build something into your tax rate to create a fund balance. We're not doing that here. We're not building anything into this rate that will create new fund balance. We're actually taking a little bit away from it. Again, going back to what Laura and I have stressed at the work sessions, we're not just looking at 16, 17. We're looking at 17, 18, 18, 19, and what the projections may be. I think next year's council, too, regardless of what you do with this particular budget, next year's council and school committee will have some tough decisions to make with respect to fund balance, because both parties, both the town council and the school committee, used some fund balance last year and they're using it again this year. And you've heard me talk about this in the water fund for years. You can only do that so long before you have to replenish that fund. But we don't have a mechanism to replenish the fund balance as of now.
Thank you. Tom?
First off, I want to apologize. I always show up in sweats, but it's just because I'm always coming from some practice. So it's not trying to be disrespectful. I just came to speak a little bit about the school budget, and the thing that I'm not hearing a lot of debate, and I think it's a good thing, is it's not as if we're debating the budget. I think the acting town manager and the superintendent both have created budgets that are, you would say, reasonable in that they're trying their best to be fair. The part that I'm having a little bit of problem with, and I think it's a debate that a lot of people have had, is the concept of capital budget, capital expenditures. And when I got up here and spoke the last time, we were talking about the HVAC system, and it doesn't matter whether it's HVAC or it's buses or it's parking lots or it's anything. The concept is just that nothing gets cheaper as you put them off. whether you're funding the pension or anything, everything that you put off just gets more expensive. So for a, whether it's a school committee or whether it's a town council, if you can make those cuts and you attain your budget that you were looking for, but that puts pressure on the next council or the next people down the line to provide an excellent school system or to provide a sensible budget that's fair, I just think it gets difficult. These are things that no one is debating that need to be done or that shouldn't have been done for quite some time. So when we look at these budgets, I just think that is something we have to take into account. And with the opportunity for, I think the number was close to 90, but let's say it's 75% of the proposal, the capital expenditure proposals from the school committee could be met with the RIDE 35% state-funded payment. If we're looking at, say, $7 to $8 million worth of capital expenditures, and you're taking 35% out, that's roughly $2 million. It could be a couple hundred thousand either way, but that seems to me to be something that would, if we're looking at, we talk about getting a grant from for the towers or for the land grant. Those are things that are important at $50,000, but at $2 million. I'm not sure that you're going to get a better deal than that. And if it does mean that you have to pay more or you have to increase something, sometimes I think we just have to accept that that's what has to be done. And if we're talking about level funding and we have no means of increasing our fund balance, and we now know that's going to create what Mr. Cizeron said was that that's going to create problems down the line, it just seems like those are issues that we should really consider for not just for now, but for down the line. And it just seems like this argument, this debate isn't over how many books we need or how many classrooms or those things seem to have been met. This seems to be about big decisions that need to be going forward. And I think that looking at things like school buses and things like HVAC systems for the kids is just something that we should not be necessarily putting our kids on old school buses or school buses that have already been appreciated, having your depreciation done, and they're now not giving us value. Those are things that are costing us money. Anyway, that was my point. The ability to jump on this ride as a capital expenditure product from the state just seems to be too good to be true at 35%. And those are things that we should be really seriously taking a look at. And we're so close to getting this budget met and where we are. I think everybody, when everybody's a little uncomfortable and everybody feels they got a little bit of something, I think that's when we're probably as close to where we should be. So I just wanted to say that, and thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Matt, if I can, just to address Tom's comment, we're not recommending delaying the HVAC project. If you will recall, there is still $70,000 in the proposed budget for the design of the HVAC systems. It will probably take 6 to 8 months to go through all of that design and permitting process, and the school committee had requested that the project be done in 17-18, so we have not proposed pushing it back. The other reason for doing the design now and proposing the construction in 17-18, it'll give the school committee the opportunity to vet out the RIDE process. We believe as well that if there's an opportunity to take advantage of the state funding, the town should do that. That probably wouldn't happen in 16-17 anyway. And Kathy can explain that better than I can, but the proposal all along was to do the HVAC in 17-18, so we're not proposing to change that.
All right, thank you. Come forward, yep. And Tom's also identified capital as one of the big expenses. As we talk about all the big expenses, the fund balance being healthy and the pensions, but go ahead, yeah.
Hi, Kathy Fogarty. I just want to thank you very much for taking the time to listen to us in the past couple weeks, and I would urge you to support this budget. And I really appreciate the fact that you all went back to the table and looked at where you could help a little bit to make us meet our goals. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, just personally, from my point of view, I think we are at that point where everybody is equally dissatisfied with the bottom line on that. When the town manager presented the budget to us, and it is his budget until we pass it, then we own it right now. He owns it. It consisted of a 1.6% tax increase for everyone, 1.5% that for commercial. When we went into through the process of the budget, there was agreement. Some of us, you know, we all had different opinions on what we should be doing with that figure. The compromise was to bring it up to 1.9%. That was a compromise. In the perfect world, everybody walks away from the table happy with it. That's a really good deal. But you know, we don't live in the perfect world, so I think we all pretty much walked away from this table, you know, not quite happy, but satisfied enough. It's my I understand that the superintendent of schools is satisfied enough. I'm satisfied enough. As far as Stanley's comment of bringing the tax increase down to zero, that wasn't in the cards from the get-go. And Jeff would never even couldn't present a budget like that. So I think we are where we are. Not everybody's happy, but I think there's mutual agreement on going forward with this budget as it's been presented tonight.
And I think that I'd like to thank Jeff and Laura very much, and certainly Kathy and Karen, for putting the budget together the way that they did. When you look at the consumer price index increase for the last 50 years, it's averaged 2.5%. If you keep your budget under an increase of 2.5%, you're doing pretty good. You get it down to 1.9, you're doing great. That's the way I see it.
If there's no one else on the public hearing, then just as I mentioned, there will we have tentatively scheduled a workshop, we want to see what the council's prerogative. Some people saying they're settled now, we did say that we would not close the workshops yet, and that is tentatively for April 27th. But again, thank you everybody. Thank you for all the participation in the budget process, and thank you for all the voices that came forward throughout the whole process. So
I guess my question here is, you know, if there is agreement that this is an acceptable budget, do we need to hold it for the workshop?
I think the point of the workshop was, I think we're not in agreement with bringing the pension down from 104 to 100. We were not in agreement with taking the fund balance down 100,000. And I think right now, Jeff and Laura have presented something that's pretty nice, and a lot of it has to do with, you know, Karen and Kathy's input over the last week. I'm happy with this the way it is. I don't see a need for another one, but if you guys prefer, I'll be there. But I don't see a need for another vetting.
Yeah, I think that's
sure
what I'm saying.
Stanley would want one.
Just so the public knows, that's why I'm saying tentative, because I think we kind of were at a place we really felt we wanted one at the last workshop. Now, each of the council members, if all five of us say we don't need another workshop, then we're not going to have it. And so I just want to be upfront with the public. That's kind of, it's a scheduling thing at this point. Do we feel the need to do that or not? We did hear some things tonight, you know, so we might want to reflect on those. But that's why, Chris. So,
yeah, when I mentioned that, and Stanley brought it up, when I mentioned that I thought that that as it was presented, the income to this town was understated by a couple hundred thousand, and Stanley had mentioned, hey, there may be a windfall, never mind a shortfall. I don't believe there's going to be a windfall, Stanley. I think we have to be prepared. And I hate to point out that you started it. But I think that a 1.9% increase is very respectful. And I think that we can cover that, what I think is going to be a shortfall of income. I think we'll cover it with this budget. I'm not afraid.
When we finished with our work session on the budget the last time, we were talking about an additional work session to iron out the differences. In the interim, the superintendent of schools and the town manager seem to have come to a figure that everybody seems to agree on. I guess my question is, we just want to close the public hearing and consider this a first reading tonight.
Well, I don't think we can do that.
Sure.
And No, we can't.
We don't have to.
We still have to prepare the ordinance for the first reading for May 2nd. You know, one of the other things that I would mention too is, you know, the difference between 1.6 and 1.9 in a almost $55 million budget, with $49 million of that being as tax levy. That can be the difference between a collection rate of, say, 98.5% and 98.8%. I mean, we're almost, I don't want to use the term splitting hairs, but we're getting close to that now. We believe that the 98.5% collection rate is very achievable. The town has, in prior years, achieved more than that. You know, knock on wood, we have very few delinquent taxes that we fail to collect on, at least in the following year. So I think we're going to hit the 16-cent mark, which ends up being 1.6 on the tax rate, even though the levy may be a little bit more depending on the collection rate. But I feel comfortable that we're right where we should be.
And Jeff, the budget is the most, you know, for the town, it's the most important thing we do. So I think that we were at a place at our last work session where we just weren't at resolution. There was a lot of different points of view. So again, tentatively scheduled, if the council does not, we may say, you know what, I'm good with this, you know, but I'd like to reflect a little more. I don't think that the public
You threw a date out there.
I put the 27th out.
That's a tentative date.
Let's put that as a tentative date.
If we don't need to,
we may not need it.
Let's call it off.
We may not need it. That's why I keep saying tentative, but I want to be upfront with everybody that it's. We were really committed to it on Thursday night.
But after I received.
We were very committed.
After I received what Jeff sent and looked it over, it's just. This is very nice. You people have done such a nice job. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. So we'll close the public hearing. Will there be a motion to close this public hearing on the budget?
Moved. Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item number 12, a motion to approve the request from St. Thomas More Parish for a prayer service followed by the gathering around a fire pit at Gazebo Park on Tuesday, June 21st, 2016, from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m., subject to state and local regulations.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. This item comes from Steve. Are there any questions for Steve? Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Number 13, a motion to approve the multi-community shelter plan agreement with the towns of South Kingston, North Kingston, Red Cross, and the town of Narragansett, and a motion to authorize the acting town manager to sign the said agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. This item comes from Scott. Are there any questions for Scott about the shelter plan agreement, which is about the basically the shelters during storms, during the major storms like blizzards and hurricanes that we have with other towns?
I understood it.
Hearing.
Is there anything that you wanted to say, Scott? Because that's quite a package you put together. I just asked if you had any comments on it. It seems quite extensive, and it's great.
Sure, I'll certainly take the opportunity. I'll keep it quick. The first one was a multi-community shelter plan. We had worked on it for quite some time. It took quite a while, as you know. You get multiple communities together to try and agree on something, it takes a little bit of time. The Red Cross was instrumental in supporting us on this. It's a good plan. It's just another example of how we share a lot of services throughout the communities. This one happened to bring in North Kingstown for the third party, along with South Kingstown. So it does not negate the ability for us to use our local shelters still if we need to. Those are still accessible to us, but what it does is bring in another commitment from another town who can help with resources, supplies, people, and have the guarantee, really, of having the Red Cross involved to help with those operational needs, such as food and people when it comes to overnight sheltering. So we're pleased to get it done.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item number 13 is a motion to approve the 14. Item number 14, a motion to approve the Memorandum of Understanding Renewal Agreement with the Red Cross and the Town of Narragansett to authorize the acting town manager to sign the said agreement.
So moved.
Second.
discussion. So this is related to that item, Scott. Any questions for Scott related to the item on the shelters during the storms, the major storms? All right, hearing none, thank you, Scott, for all your work on this. Appreciate it. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item 15, a motion to award the bid for the miscellaneous improvements to Allegash and Metatuxet pump stations and the Scarborough Wastewater Treatment Facility to the lowest bidder, Hart Engineering Corporation, in the amount of $591,035. Thank you. $591,030. I apologize, everybody. Is there a motion for that?
Second.
Discussion. Is there questions? Are there questions for Jeff on item on the wastewater treatment?
Any, I see. Stan. I got one quick one. Is there any grant money on that one?
No, no grant money on this one, unfortunately.
It's from, but the funding is in the way is part of the whole wastewater capitalized enterprise fund. So this is, we have our three enterprise funds: water, wastewater, and beach. And this is coming from that fund.
Okay. I want to commend Jeff on this thing, because we got competitive quotes. It's about a $300,000 savings here. We had a high quote of 909, and we were able to get it for 591. So the fact that we're out there actively doing our quotes is certainly so-called saving us money. And I want to thank him for doing that. And I also want to thank him for the debt-free water and sewer department, debt-free. I heard that at the sessions. I didn't bring that up, and I want to thank him for that personally. That is really an accomplishment, and I hope many of us can continue to look at debt-free. Thank you.
And Jeff, as a point, the budgeted item for this, regardless of the bids, was around 700. Is that correct?
It was around 750.
750, I'm sorry. Yeah. So again, this coming significantly under our anticipated budget, also to add to that. So 750 was the original estimate, and now it's coming in at 591. Any other questions or comments? I'm seeing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item 16 is a motion to award a contract for the services during construction for the miscellaneous improvements to Allegash and Metatuxet pump stations and the Scarborough Wastewater Treatment Facility project to James J. Jeremiah and Associates Incorporated in an amount not to exceed $48,560.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Again, this item comes from Jeff. Are there any questions for Jeff? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 4-0. Item number 17 is a motion to introduce, read, and accept as a first reading a resolution to implement time seasonal parking restrictions on Ocean Road between South Pier Road and Beach Street.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Chris, this item comes from you, so do you want to speak to it?
Sure. All the council members received a memo from the town engineer probably about a month ago, throwing the idea out, pretty much because we're so quickly approaching the summer season, was there interest in pursuing this course of action. Didn't hear much other than it was generally positive, those who did weigh in, so I put it on the agenda. And if I may just to summarize it by reading the summary as it's written. The subject of timed seasonal parking on Ocean Road has been discussed between town councils, our residents and local business owners and the staff for many years. In 2011, the town commissioned a parking study that also recommended regulated parking along Ocean Road seawall. The advantages of this proposal are as follows. Number one, transit parking opportunities for local restaurants and commercial businesses will increase. Under the current unregulated system, many of the approximately 206 parking spots along the seawall are occupied during summer by daily visitors to the beach. These spots are often occupied throughout most of the day, limiting parking availability for businesses and restaurant customers. The Narragansett Chamber of Commerce has expressed support of this proposal, and I believe that they are here to testify to that this evening. Number two, the seawall is one of Narragansett's prime attractions in the summer months. As stated above, the lack of parking restrictions in this area limits the opportunities for residents and guests alike that just want to walk the seawall from parking during the summer months. As it was primarily because on-site beach parking lot. Number three, the town beach loses parking revenue by the fact that free all-day parking is currently available along Ocean Road between Beach Street and South Pier Road. Number four, the proposed regulation would be complementary to the new trolley services. This proposal recommends that a parking system free of charge, but be restricted to 3 hours parking both sides from the intersection of Ocean Road to South Pier Road to the intersection of Ocean Road, Beach Street from June 20th to Labor Day inclusive each year between the hours of 7 in the morning to 5 in the evening. Police Department would be in charge of enforcing these restrictions, and the Department of Public Works would post seasonal signage accordingly. Now, the hours of restriction for these summer hours of restriction are between 7 in the morning and 5 in the afternoon. But the effective times of these restrictions are between 7 in the morning and 2 o'clock in the afternoon, because it is a three-hour parking restriction. If you park your car there, obviously, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you can stay through 5 and through to the next morning, actually. I'll open it up for discussion. It's something we've been, it's time to, at least in my opinion, just to either get this done, or I don't want to hear about it again. We've been talking about this forever. There's pros and cons to everything. I'm sure we'll go through some of those tonight. But the idea is to have the beach wall accessible by everyone, not just the people who want to use it for beach parking. And I would move passage tonight.
So we'll open it up to the public. I know that we had the beach workshop in the fall of 2015, where there was discussion about parking in the outer parts of the pier, where not the seawall itself, because people were getting frustrated that people were doing what Chris was describing, parking there all day in the neighborhoods. And so that was a concern at the beach workshop in the fall. And so I know that Dean at the time, who was the police chief, and now Sean kind of inherited some of the planning of what we would do for that, for those, what I'm calling the outer seawall streets, like the Congdons and the streets by the Dunes Club. We also had, which is somewhat related to this, but is a little different, the ad hoc subcommittee on parking, which they also had some proposals. Now, those were more related to the issues associated with
the students,
but that was something that, you know, I know that the police chief and the chair of that subcommittee were gonna get together. And I know Dean had been working on this, and then Sean, again, has been working on it. So it just seems there's a lot of pieces to it. So want to see what the public has to say about it.
Anyone?
Kate? Yeah.
Hi. I had a question about, at the towers we have probably 10-day events the summer between June 20th and Labor Day. It's Leadership Rhode Island from 8 in the morning until 3:30 in the afternoon. There are several fire departments that have meetings that I think are longer than 3 hours. We have one tomorrow that's longer than 3 hours. You're limited to 3 hours, and you don't pay any money. So then, are you ticketed for $50 or $80 for going over that period of time? What happens?
Currently, I think it's $35.
Yes, a $35 ticket for parking overtime.
Yeah. That's what's in the ordinance.
Normally, what I find, see, Ocean Road, that the Ocean Road area we're talking about is a state road.
Right.
And as a state road, we have certain leeway to regulate it. But any regulation we impose upon Ocean Road has to apply to everyone. So it's not like we can give out hang tags. And that's an issue. That's something we'd like to do for the local businesses. I think the businesses can adapt, because I think what they're going to find off, the trade-off is far greater with the additional customers they'll have for the first time ever. Because remember, those customers come, they start rolling. The full-time parkers, the beach parking, usually starts around 8 o'clock in the morning and stops around noonish, 1 o'clock. And what this will do, will pretty much give everybody still the opportunity to use the beach. It'll give everybody the opportunity to go to their business they want to go to their restaurant, and do pretty much what they want to do. The camper that comes in there and sets up for the day is just no longer going to be able to set up for the day. They'll have 3 hours like everybody else. But we can't make exceptions. Now, your day events, being on the Towers Committee for all these years, I know that you have 10 that are encompass the daytime. And like I said, there has to be some adaption right there, but I always find out if you have an event in the middle of daytime in the summer, you can't find parking. For instance, if you have a wedding in the middle of the afternoon, and remember, this is only really effective till 2 o'clock in the afternoon,
right,
from 7 till 2 in the afternoon. But usually, I'm finding. I remember the days when I used to go, was allowed to go to these meetings. I'm finding that people realize that who booked the towers, that they couldn't find parking anyway.
In July and August, for weddings on the weekends, we ask that people not start their event until 4. Mm-hmm. However, mm-hmm, the caterers are there before then, and their staff is there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And parking is hard. So
yeah,
I just was trying to understand, yeah, what effect this will have on events
on tower events. Unless Jeff has some creative...
Chris, I've heard from a few businesses also that are worried about that same exact thing. It's not
sure.
So much the people parking there who are attending the events or the people coming to dinner. It's more the people who work there in the restaurant.
The employees.
The people the employees and the people who come to work for the caterers and so forth. They need a place to park, and those parking spaces are taken up. Now, whether this can be adjusted a little bit or not, because it seems that we're trying to go after is these people get there at 7 in the morning and just stay there all day, and we want to open it up so that there's more available for businesses and for the towers people, but I don't know that this is accomplishing that, and it might need a little bit more thought. But I don't know. I'm concerned that I've gotten so many calls on it.
This is something we put on there. Just it's something we want to really pursue right now. Get it done in time for this. Get it done or not get. Hopefully get it done or not get it done. Time for this season. You have to be, always be keenly aware that being a state road, it's not a designated beach parking lot, and it's not a designated employee parking lot.
Yeah.
It's for the people of Narragansett. Being a state road, you have to be very careful with the rights of all taxpayers in Rhode Island, because the road was built and is maintained and funded by all the taxpayers. So it's always been my view that everybody should have an opportunity to use it. Yeah. One of the problems we've had with employee parking, especially recently, the council over the years has arranged neighborhood parking that it's very, very restrictive. If you start at the, say you start at the towers, and you start heading south on Ocean Road, you have Taylor Street, no parking, permit only. Then you hit Central Street, no parking, permit only. And right on down and through the neighborhoods, it's very restrictive. So I can't see where cars would be pushed into the local neighborhoods because they can't park there anyway.
Yeah.
And in essence, almost what we've done is we've sort of created a private parking situation on taxpayer-funded local roads when it comes right down to it.
I don't know.
But we heard the complaint, Chris. Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead. I don't know that I totally agree with that because there's so many people come in at 7 o'clock in the morning, parking it, getting on the beach before the beach opens, and spending the day. I think there's a lot of people. I think that's kind of where I'm focused on trying to relieve those parking spaces for, you know, the towers, for the businesses. I look at it from, Narragansett has a beautiful view. It's been the same for so many years that people are just allowed to come and go. But the place that I think that it's being abused is the beach parking. That's what where I think it's being abused. And it's because we have such a beautiful beach because, you know, Steve's doing such a great job. I don't know. This is a tough one. And I wouldn't mind continuing this until the next meeting so we can get, you know, the input from our friend who's missing, if you wouldn't mind that. That would probably give a little time for us to think about it a little bit.
Sure, if that's a pleasure of the council this evening. We can't wait too long because we're getting right up on Memorial Day weekend.
How about if we continue a date certain for the next meeting?
But I would point out, too, the parking, even though it's 7 in the morning, which those are the hours you do want to start. You want to start marking. And effectively, it ends at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So the businesses, the restaurants that have employee situations for their evening staff, they won't have a problem. It's what it is, it's that little narrow gap in the afternoon that has to be dealt with. I think that can be dealt with. You know, I always rely on the businesses to creatively deal with that situation. And the trade-off is, what's first priority here for the businesses, more customers or easier parking for the employees? You know, that's something that, you know, has to be discussed.
But the businesses seem to be doing well right now in the summertime at lunchtime. I go back to, I think the complaint was in those outer neighborhoods. I know on some there's parking permits, but we got that complaint very squarely at the work session on the beach about those, the next layer of streets, and that was kind of the concern. The seawall, I remember sitting in the audience.
Up a few blocks, you talking?
Yeah, like the woods and Congdon and Central, and
Congdon's no parking.
I remember sitting out in the audience when this came up before the in 2011, 2012, when people were talking about yet meters on the wall, and there was just a lot of opposition to the meters on the wall. And so, you know, I think some people also see this as part of that. But Kate, did you want to add anything? I'm going to bring Dennis up.
No. And, just let me to the point. See, we've systematically gone through a process of elimination, different scenarios that we could hopefully alleviate that and give everyone a chance to enjoy the seawall in the area there in town. And we've eliminated the parking meters right off the bat because they're unsightly. It's just, you know, sight pollution. You just don't go. We've eliminated the kiosks. You know, the one you go out, actually, you put a credit card in and you put it up, go back to your car. This was the simplest, most direct solution that we saw. And as far as the second layering of the, obviously, there are tremendous restrictions on the parking in the Central Pier area. And as you go out, the only real street that I see needs attention is at South Trail, which is off of Wood, because it's a dead end. And everything else on Wood, it's no parking, like everywhere else. It's no parking or permit parking. Now Wood, they found that little niche in there. Now that should be dealt with, but that's a separate cover.
Thank you. I see Dennis and then Chris Lacanole. Thank you, Kate.
So I think, like a lot of other folks, we've heard about this year in and year out, and Chris's recommendation of either doing something and then, you know, striking it from the vocabulary for all times might be the right approach. I would be a big supporter of it. I don't know if all of the, there could be wrinkles that could be added into it to accommodate some of the issues that we're talking about. I mean, the towers is such a, you know, remarkable community, you know, energizer, that I'd love to make sure we can think of things that could help. I would think anything in the afternoon. So I walk the seawall all the time. I ride my bike in the seawall in the summer. It is from earliest in the morning, it's a cement wall of cars. Once they've been put there, those cars are going to stay there for 6 hours, 8 hours, 10 hours. So I think anything that can sort of loosen that up, certainly to try it for a year would be, I think, would be progress. I'm wondering if in Kate's situation on the full day events, if there could be any accommodation, if people are really coming at 8 o'clock in the morning, if there could be any accommodation with the related parking lots for the beach, whether that could be built into, if there's a fee. I'm not sure, you know, what the members of those committee, of those conferences do, but whether there's an extra $5 or $10 in there to pay for beach parking, whether something could be worked out with a newly created shuttle. But I think it would be, I think it would be a great first step to try it. Maybe the hours are too long now. Maybe the hours actually have, maybe it's really just about trying to blow up that cement wall in the morning, which is when everyone races down and jumps over the seawall or beats people on the beach and they don't even pay a fee to be on the beach. So I think the notion is something that would be terrific to implement. And if Kate and Jeff and, you know, Steve would have the time to speak for a couple of hours, there might be 3 or 4 or 5 good enhancements to this that could really make it work. And I was at that meeting too, Matt, and what Dean presented was really a comprehensive approach with the seawall and with the outlying
roads. But he didn't really, he was gonna work on it further though as well,
right,
if you remember.
But yeah. That was what he had, the design that he had in place. I don't know how much that's been refined since then. So I think it's something it really bears spending more time on. Hopefully the concerned parties could get together and make some accommodations back to the council so we could act on it.
To your point about working out the wrinkles, because this would be the first year we've actually done something about this. And of course we're gonna find wrinkles. We have to start somewhere. That was my only point of putting it on the agenda and see where it goes. We've been looking into, once we got permission from the state to actually go ahead with this restrictive parking on the beach there, we had to find out, you know, for signage. If you noticed on the west side of Ocean Road, there are street lights that we could put our signages up. We want to make that minimal signage as possible, but we have to do that on the east side as well.
Right.
Now that we're going through what's the minimal amount of signs we could use to still be legal and to be fair. And those would be, all the signage would be removed at the end of the season. They're not permanent signage. This is just to help us with the summer months. And as far as I know there's and we got to talk this out, there is apprehension in the business community as what do we do with our employees. But when we the EDC voted on this unanimously at the time, the owner of George's, Kevin Durfee, testified that it almost seems to make such a move on the parking might seem counterintuitive to some people as far as employee parking. But he noticed when the regulations were changed in Galilee to limited summer parking, limited hours, he noticed right away his uptick in business, which is one of them. You want this to be it's very pro-business by default. It's good for the idea is you want to help the businesses, obvious, and this has been a target of trying to help the businesses to maintain and to prosper down there. But you also want to make this to be very much for the townspeople, to give them a shot at parking at their own seawall.
And to restate, the timing couldn't be better with the commencement of the shuttle service. I think that it just, you know, it's kismet, it comes together. So hopefully you'll consider it seriously.
Matt, if I can, one thing that, and actually Ann and I have been going back and forth through the parking ordinances and regulations. As you know, we give business owners permits for their employees now. It's within a described area within the pier. It unfortunately does not include Ocean Road, but I believe that we can, with the council's concurrence, you could amend that ordinance to include Ocean Road. So this could be a two-step process. One, to direct the staff to do timed parking on the seawall. And the second, to amend the ordinance to include Ocean Road within that area where commercial establishments could obtain parking passes for their employees. Now, they'd have to be parking passes on the side streets because, as you stated, DOT said we can't treat people differently on Ocean Road. But, you know, on the other streets, it works that way, too. For example, the picnic basket, they get a certain number of parking passes for their employees. We don't guarantee that they can park on Kingstown Road on their storefront. They park wherever they can find it within the pier, but it's within a permit parking area. If you look at Ocean Road, you look at the Coast Guard House and Turtle Soup, and perhaps the towers could be included in this as well. I don't think that's a lot of additional permits to be added to the mix, considering that we're regulating over 200 parking spaces. So I think that may be a partial solution to the concern amongst the business community about where their employees would park. And again, as you stated, Chris, with the timing that we're proposing of 7 to 5 with a 3-hour limit, for an employee that's coming to work at 3 p.m, this is not an issue. They're going to park for 2 hours. At 5 o'clock, the parking restrictions are lifted anyway. So they can come, theoretically, at 2:01 and park until midnight.
Yep.
But I will look into that parking, the regulation piece a little bit more, but I think we may need to do this as a two-step process, which can be done concurrently, but I think we just need to amend the commercial parking regulation area to include Ocean Road.
Yeah, Ray mentioned continuing it. I think with all these things that have come up, it might be a good idea to continue it, and if you can hammer out those things, then we could go forward with it, but if we can't, then maybe it's not something we want to do.
But I did mention continue it date certain, so that means
two weeks.
Okay, that was my
point. Yes, I'm fine with that.
Hello.
Donna DeChica. I have a question, Mr. Wilkins. Mm. When you talk about the parking in Galilee, bringing businesses, because of the parking, they have parking lots where people can go.
Yes.
Where do we send our people? Because there are no parking lots in Narragansett where we can park. The side streets are all permitted, so if our people come and there's no permit, they can't park there. So where do we go and park? Where do we have our people go to park? There are no designated parking lots in Narragansett. You have no way. Now you're saying there's a trolley. Excuse my voice, my vocal cord cracks. Where is the trolley picking up people? Where do we send them to park? At the school? We were told you can't park at the school parking lots.
Yeah, well, that's one of the things that's...
So these are things that we need to...
Those are all excellent points. Like I said, one of the problems we've had, we've made, I don't know, for right or wrong, whatever, we've made parking in Narragansett so restrictive. Where do you send people?
Exactly.
My daughter used to work at the Coast Guard House back when she was going to college, and you just didn't want to park around the Coast Guard House, you know, or on the Ocean Road, because that was where the customers parked. So everybody, I used to talk to all the waitresses and the waiters, they used to park on Narragansett Avenue. Well, they can't do that anymore.
They can't do that anymore.
And that
and
does present some...
I have a granddaughter that works there, too, and I don't want her walking at 11 or 12 o'clock.
Oh, I know. My daughter took our car all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But if she can't park on, you know, in certain areas, if she's going to work at 11 in the morning.
But the solution, we'll be working this out, possibly the solution would be to take the trolley. As you know, we've approved, the council has approved the new trolleys.
We had the trolley a couple of years ago, but where would the people go to park?
This is where they park their car, right at the middle school.
Okay.
See, the trolley can have two runs, the business to business, making a loop, and one, perhaps we can, you know, have just a shot right down to the beach area, right down there.
Because at the towers, I do want to say, I mean, I know we have 10 this year, but we had a lot last year. We had the police chiefs. It was a hassle because they couldn't park on Matthewson. It was two-hour parking.
Oh, I know.
We had them going in and out, moving their cars. It's ridiculous. You're renting it as a facility to have business meetings, to have weddings, to have whatever we have, which we do have a lot of things going on there. And to have your guests running out to move their cars is like...
And when you try...
That's not user-friendly.
And when you try to alleviate that with a comprehensive parking system for the pier, we've been talking about that since, I don't know how long, since at least 2006.
Exactly.
It's like the third rail, because you get one person on the street who wants totally restricted parking, permit only. Yeah. Then the very next person wants unlimited parking. And what's the council going to do?
Exactly. You have to go down the middle, but you can't make it too restrictive.
Well, I think that as we maybe close the door here, we can open up some other windows.
Okay.
Thank you. Chris?
Good evening. I'm Chris Lackanoy. I'm the chair of the town EDC. And Chris Wilkins and Dennis sort of stole my thunder here a little bit, but this issue came up last week at our regular EDC meeting, and we voted unanimously in support of this resolution. And it goes back to initially when we brought in the Sullivans to talk about the trolley proposal back in December. And what they indicated was that for the first year of their trolley operations, you know, they were going to be growing and learning and getting an awareness from the community on being able to use the trolley, but that if we were able to adopt some sort of parking solution, it would enhance their ability to deliver on the shuttle because people would start using the shuttle more often, and the more that they would use it, the more stops the Sullivans could add, the more it would be cost effective and would drive the price down. So we did talk about, with regards to the elementary school parking lot, that is the solution. Now I want to go back to one point that was mentioned about Kevin Durfee and George's. He found that after these regulations were put in place in Galilee, his employees started they developed a whole carpooling system, which sounds a little bit like a nuisance, but what it ended up doing was freed up all the space for the customers, and he saw a difference. So we would say that while there are, he came up with that carpooling system, we kind of already have a system in place now with the trolley, and so we'd urge as a committee that you all take a look at this, and if it does get delayed tonight to a later date, as soon as possible, because we need the Sullivans to have a heads up on that so that they can plan for that and have the capacity to be able to support it. But just to make clear, their plans would include service where basically employees could park at the elementary school and get dropped off right there at the Coast Guard house. So I can't imagine how much more convenient. And those shuttles are going to be running every 10 to 20 minutes. So that's about as safe and as fast as we could make it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So do you want to make the motion to continue?
I would make the motion to continue to the next meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion, all opposed, motion approved 4-0. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, motion approved 4-0. Thank you, everybody. Have a great night. Thank you.